Sandra.
All full up. Can't carry any more. Space for that. Looks like this is the only way, okay? There's a temple down there. I got Unuratu captured. What's Dominguez gonna do with her? As long as he needs the box, he'll keep her alive. I hope. November 26th, 1603. At dinner, Lopez asked me if I believed these heathens were worthy of the artifact's alleged power. I had to admit that the Paititians seemed noble and industrious. However, their taut skin, stretched tight over sinewy muscles, and lack of shame made them more similar to beasts. "And what of our leaders in the society?" he then asked. "Should they be able to wave their perfumed and ring fingers in any direction and expect us to obey, to return and sit at their side when they beckon? Do they not treat us as inferior beings, as beasts as well?" I had no answer. What he'd said was heresy and treason, but in some way, I wondered if it wasn't the truth. Who made these things? It's not Maya or Inca. high. Then I could dive. Another example of syncretic belief. This figure portrayed on the cross is not Jesus Christ, but Kukulcan. I suppose a parallel could be drawn between the two. Thank you. Detailed engravings on this helmet, in its unusually good condition, could mean this helmet was worn more as an accessory rather than protection in combat. Perhaps Lopez used it to project an air of importance. They carried a sacred object to a great temple. The Box of Isha. What was that? Rubbing taken from the walls of the cenote. It is simply a large X and the word run. 1st of December, 1603. We've entered a cenote not far from the city and set up camp in a small alcove. Lopez has spent the evening staring into the flames, utterly ensorcelled, his dinner untouched. Twice I attempted a conversation, but his silence rebuffed me each time. He is utterly focused on this artifact. If I were a more superstitious man, I would wonder if the artifact is speaking to him directly. The soldiers keep to themselves as well. They seem anxious for battle. One of their dogs stared at me all evening, as though I were to be his next meal. Thank you. There must have been an incredible battle here. The falconet would be heavy enough to destroy the barricade. All full up. Can't carry any more. The falconet would be heavy enough to destroy the barricade. This seems to be some kind of primitive sculpture of a human. I don't have enough space for that. Could definitely use this raft to reach the hull. There's a falconet hanging from that boom yard. Even rusted out, you can tell this is a quality weapon. It was likely manufactured in Toledo. The city was renowned for their steelwork. The notches on the blade suggest several battles. Falconet's in position. path to the front of the ship. Won't budge. There's a winch on the foremast. All full up. Can't carry any more. Shit. The boom swung out too far to reach. Rotate this boom so it's in front of the crate. abandoned ship. We underestimated the natives, crafty bastards. Told us of a cave filled with gold, but they led us into a trap. The damn place was filled with monsters. After a ferocious battle, we pushed them back. The remaining men loaded the ship with whatever valuables we could find. The battle must have weakened the cabin, for when we tried to escape, it collapsed. I hear them out there, even now, digging through the barriers. Just a noise. These must be the Trinity soldiers who went missing. Time to move. impossible. I can't carry any more. This rosary has 6 decades instead of the usual 5. A very ornate example of the Brigantine version. There appears to be an engraving, Andreas Lopez. There we go. Dated. Strange warriors pursued us through the caverns. We moved quickly, too quickly for an accurate description. Most of the soldiers fell in battle. They were valiant, but outmatched and outnumbered. Eventually, Lopez, I, and a single surviving soldier reached a magnificent temple. I cannot imagine how the people managed to build such a structure so deep underground. A massive door blocked our progress. Lopez, his voice frantic and breaking, ordered Perez, the last remaining conquistador, to stand guard while we worked on the mechanism. The door began to roll open. Our celebration of success was drastically cut short by the dying screams of Perez. The sound haunts me still. December 1603. A strange noise woke me in the middle of the night. I found Lopez still staring at the fire, though now it was nothing but coals. I asked him if he'd heard the noise as well, but all he did was grunt. I wrapped a blanket about his shoulders and built up the fire again. Then I sat and listened. Far off shrieks and hisses, likely distorted by the twists of the caverns. But underneath all those sounds, I heard a faint thrum. I've heard something like that before, but rarely, and only when in the deepest of prayers. It sounded like the voice of God. Look at all this. What's behind that door? Anymore. Snake spigot to the crank. All right. Almost done.
Hey!
I'll need to tether that snake spigot to the crank. I'll need to tether that snake spigot to the crank. Turn the spigot to fill the basin. Position the spigot so the water flows to the wheel.
Oh, no.
use the crank to position the spigot so the water flows to the wheel. I'll need to use the crank to position the spigot so the water flows to the wheel.
These figures, they look like those creatures, but they're graceful. Yashil, goddesses of protection. The silver box of Ishel was forged in paradise and brought to earth. Did those creatures make the box? Neither false gods nor zealots shall be allowed to pass. They're protecting it. Is that why they fought me so viciously? Here they keep the box until the sun's renewal. Here. It has to be here. Eclipse and a heron, like the tattoos on Onuratu's arm. But where's the box?
Yeah. Yeah!